Well, hi, everybody. First, I'd like to thank Amy for that wonderful introduction. It's kind of weird being introduced. I'm very glad that I was asked to introduce such a historic member of the conservative movement and a key member of Young Americans for Freedom. Being a huge history nerd, especially when it comes to the conservative movement, this is a great opportunity that I'm very thankful for. Now, when it comes to YAF history, there are few books out there that really nail it, and it covers everything you'd ever want to know. And this gentleman right here has written those few books. And he has quite the history with YAF. He originally joined in 1961 and eventually moved up through the ranks to become the executive director of Young Americans for Freedom. But that's not all he's done. Throughout his history, he has actually been a executive director of the Republican Party of Texas, as well as an appointee to the Department of Education, as well as the Housing and Urban Development Department under the Reagan and Bush administrations. Today, I'm sure we'll get to hear a lot about his books. He is actually an author of some very, very interesting books. First off, and probably my favorite so far, A Generation Awakes. And this is the complete history of YAF. And it's very detailed. So if you ever want to learn the history of YAF, this is the book to do it. And I'm almost done. I'm at 477 right now. And to show you how much I like this book, I just got back from a Disney cruise, and I spent most of it reading and annotating this book. But this isn't his only work that we should talk about. He also has written Red State, an insider story to how the GOP came to dominate Texas politics. And as you know, other than Austin, the GOP still dominates Texas politics. But today, I think we should take a special moment and look at his newest book, which I'm very excited to start, and that's Igniting a Movement. And I'm sure we'll hear all about it today. And this covers most of what's in the other book, but as well as how conservatives are doing things on campuses, such as activism and hosting speakers in the 21st century, and even how YAF has almost reignited and made a huge impact on the conservative movement. And I think that we all should give Wayne Thorburn a huge round of applause and thank him for being here. Wayne?
Thank you. Well, thank you, Kyle, and thank you, Amy, for the introduction. It's a pleasure to be here on this historic occasion of President Reagan's birthday, and I'm glad to have been able to be here for all of the activities, including this morning's activities of introducing to the public some of the Zelda Munch letters and also some of the items that had been the Reagans when they were at the Bel Air location. And so today, what I thought I would do, since it is Reagan's birthday, is tell you a little bit about what is in this book, and hopefully I think if you would like, you'll have a copy later, and I'd be glad to sign those for anyone who wants a copy. Igniting a Movement is really an update and a condensation of some of the items that were in the book that Kyle mentioned earlier, A Generation Awakes. If you really want to read all 550 pages that Kyle mentioned, this book is available downstairs. They have it for sale in the welcome area downstairs. It was published in 2010. A lot has happened with Young Americans for Freedom since this book was published, and that was really one of the reasons for coming up with this condensed, this is about 200 pages, I think, but it's also updating what's been happening since Young Americans for Freedom became part of Young America's foundation in 2011, and the growth and the rebirth of Young Americans for Freedom over the last 5 or 6 years. But what I'd like to do is tell you a little bit about how Young Americans for Freedom came about, and then emphasize particularly the ties to President Reagan, or to Ronald Reagan as he was when he first became involved with Young Americans for Freedom. Because on this day, it's important that we remember and tie in the contributions to the conservative movement that Ronald Reagan made, not only as president, but as an individual before and after his presidency. Well, Young Americans for Freedom in many ways can be viewed as the kind of the precursor of Young America's Foundation. The names are very similar, and the reason for that is because those who were involved in the ground level of creating Young America's Foundation were all individuals who had been active in Young Americans for Freedom. And so it was kind of seen at the beginning as the tax-exempt arm of Young Americans for Freedom, the charitable foundation arm of the organization, and then subsequently divided off on its own and had its own existence as a separate organization. And then, as I mentioned, in 2011, kind of the circle came around again, and Young America's Foundation incorporated Young Americans for Freedom into its circle of student activities. But how did Young Americans for Freedom start, and why is it important? Well, first of all, we have to go back to a period of time after the 1950s. It's September of 1960, and on a weekend, it's unfortunate that these dates somehow are associated with a tragic event in our history now, but on September 9 through 11 of 1960, almost 100 young conservatives, most of whom were college students, all came at their own expense to the little town of Sharon, Connecticut, for a meeting that was held at the family home of William F. Buckley, Jr., his parents' home, in other words. And at that place in Sharon, Connecticut, the home was called Great Elm, these 100 individuals, the oldest of whom was 27. So when we talk about, from my perspective, looking back now, boy, those people were all young, and indeed they were. There were a few older people there who were just observers of it, and those older people were people like Bill Buckley, William F. Buckley, Jr., and the person who was the publisher of National Review, Bill Rusher, another person by the name of Brent Bozell, and another person by the name of Marvin Liebman. They were the oldsters, and not one of those was over 38. So that gives you a little perspective, especially at my age, it gives me a perspective when somebody who's in their 30s is being regarded as the oldster. So this was a young group, almost all of whom were college students. And out of that meeting, they created an organization that continues today, some 55, 56 years later, as a youth organization of young conservatives. And Young Americans for Freedom was really the first grassroots conservative organization to take hold in the United States, made up of young people who were predominantly college students, but also some high school students and a few young adults, people who were just recently out of college or into the work world. And one of the things that they did, not only in creating an organization, but they adopted a statement of principles, which is referred to as the Sharon Statement. And in the back of this book and in also the other book is the Sharon Statement. It's a very brief, concise statement of basic conservative principles that, with a few exceptions, including some of the references to communism, still holds today as the basic fundamental beliefs of what is the American conservative movement. It's been reprinted and used many times by other groups, inciting it as a concise statement of what conservatives actually believe. Now, after that organization was formed in 1960, they went through a process of trying to establish themselves and becoming, as Bill Buckley said, eventually they were becoming a presence in the room. They were becoming an entity that was respected and accepted. And probably the most important decision that they made early in their career was really twofold. One was they started a magazine called The New Guard that was published monthly and gave an opportunity for the first time for young conservative writers to have their material published and to discuss issues from a conservative, youthful perspective. Young Americans for Freedom continued to publish that magazine on a regular basis through the 1980s, and it's been resuscitated now in the modern world, not as a printed document, but as an online publication on the website of Young America's Foundation. In the 21st century, the printed word has been supplanted in many cases by the internet and the blogs and the other online publications. The second thing they did is they decided if they were going to make a mark, they wanted to have some event that would really put them on the road to acceptance as a serious conservative organization. And so, with many gulps, they took on the responsibility of holding a rally for, I think the exact term was for liberation from world communism, a rally for liberation from world communism. Remember, this is in the early 60s. And they signed a contract to rent Madison Square Garden, which, of course, historically has always been a place where many political events and sporting events and other things were held in the heart of Manhattan and New York City. And I think Madison Square Garden at that time probably had seating capacity of about 18,000 people. And so here was this new youth organization formed in September of 1960, and they're going to have a rally in March of 1962. And lo and behold, not only were they able to line up a number of conservative speakers at that time, including Senator Barry Goldwater and Senator John Tower, who was a recently elected conservative Republican from Texas, and some John Dos Passos, who was a famous writer, and some other people of stature to be on the program. When the day came in March of 1962, not only was the hall filled, but there were 4,000 to 5,000 people, according to the New York police, outside who couldn't get in because of the fire marshal's limitations. It made the New York Times, it made the Washington Post, it made all the national news, and was really an essential one event that put Young Americans for Freedom on the mark as exemplifying the young conservative movement that was happening. Now, some of you who have lived through that period of time will recognize when I say that when we look back to the 1960s, the early 1960s were in many ways quite different than the latter part of the 1960s. And much of the focus of the media tends to be on the radicalism of the late 60s and the demonstrations and the riots and the burning down of the cities after some the catastrophic events that happened, the death of Martin Luther King, the death of Robert Kennedy, the riots in the cities, the riots on campuses, all of which took place in the late 60s. The early 60s was a lot different. And maybe I'll give you one example of what I mean by this. I started college in 1961. And in a year or two after that, I was invited to an event that the Young Republicans were holding. And what were they holding? They were holding an afternoon tea at a fraternity house. Now, can you imagine in the late 60s something like that happening? I don't think so. I mean, that's one indication of the distinction, and there are many others between the early 60s. And I say this because when Young Americans for Freedom came into being in 1960, the real movement and excitement politically on many campuses was from the right and not from the left. And it was associated with the Goldwater campaign and the effort to nominate Barry Goldwater in 1964. So it was quite different environment. But that brings us to Ronald Reagan and Ronald Reagan's involvement with Young Americans for Freedom. And I think I'd like to kind of go through the book and point out a few things about Ronald Reagan and his involvement. Excuse me. With the organization. And it really starts in 1962 when Young Americans for Freedom was forming an advisory board of senior conservatives, and they invited Ronald Reagan, who then was a spokesman for General Electric. He had been appearing on Death Valley Days, I think it was called, or I can't remember the name of, I think that was the television program. And he accepted, and he agreed to serve on the advisory board. And this was shortly after that rally that I just talked about. So let me read you just a little section from the book that talks about that. The YAF members left Madison Square Garden with excitement and enthusiasm and commitment. Ready to organize new campus and community chapters, YAF now claimed 310 chapters throughout a growing number of states and a national advisory board that included 38 sitting members of Congress. One of those advisory board members was a movie actor who had most recently made a career as host of a television drama series and as a motivational speaker at General Electric plants across the country. To help raise badly needed contributions, Richard Vigory, who was at the time the executive director of the organization, wrote to Ronald Reagan and asked for his help, enclosing a fundraising letter to be signed by Reagan. In words few knew at the time to be so predictive of future events, the letter had Reagan proclaiming, "I know of no other group in the nation which is going to be more effective in preserving and extending our cherished goals. There is no need to emphasize that these young people are the future leaders of the nation. As they grow and develop, so will our country." Well, weeks went by without a response, until one day an envelope came in the mail with the proposed fundraising letter enclosed. All over the letter were crayon marks, and attached was a note from Reagan. "I just found this in Ronnie's toy chest. I'm sorry it's late, but if you think my name would help, go ahead and use it." And apparently the mail had been misdirected, you might say, in the Reagan household, and ended up in little Ronnie's toy chest, where he used it to sample his various crayons. But Ronald Reagan was able to rescue it from that, and for history and for the fundraising efforts of Young Americans for Freedom, we're very glad of that. Because with that, the relationship between Ronald Reagan and Young Americans for Freedom was established, and the political career of the future president had begun. And that was from 1962. Reagan continued to be closely associated with YAF and with the conservative movement over the next few years. And the next time that he comes into contact with YAF was in 1964 at the San Francisco Republican National Convention, the convention at which Barry Goldwater was nominated for President of the United States. And on the second night of the convention, YAF held a rally for Goldwater at the Herbs Theater with Ronald Reagan as the master of ceremonies. Bill Buckley recalled the event as one of the highlights of the entire week. 5,000 persons were turned away. The auditorium was jammed with excited people, mostly under the age of 30. The press was there in force. The professionalism of the physical arrangements was impressive. Prior to Goldwater's nomination on Wednesday, the following night, YAF sponsored another rally, this time outside the Cow Palace. The Cow Palace was where the convention was being held in San Francisco. While almost 1,000 YAF members shouted for Barry, they also heard from Bob Bauman, who at that time was the YAF chairman and later a congressman, and Ronald Reagan. Speaking from a flatbed truck, Reagan told the crowd, "You were at this long before many, and God bless you for it." And so Reagan shows up as the featured speaker, not at just one, but at two YAF rallies that were held in conjunction with that Republican convention in 1964. Well, the interest in Reagan, of course, became magnified after that famous speech, "A Time for Choosing," which he gave and which was telecast in part of the Goldwater campaign in 1964. And I think President Reagan later said that really that was the focal point of starting him thinking about perhaps doing more things directly in the political arena. And certainly it's what gave him a national name and beginning of a national stature, as the reaction that was given across the country to that speech that he gave for Goldwater. And although Goldwater, of course, lost by a large margin, It was the Reagan speech was one of the highlights of that campaign. And after that, there was a great deal of interest in Ronald Reagan possibly running for governor of California. And many of his friends and associates here in this state and really across the nation started encouraging him. And one of the things, and certainly the young conservatives in YAF who had just gone through this debilitating defeat of Goldwater and their hopes somewhat allayed by that loss, were looking for someone else to lead the conservative cause, and Ronald Reagan was a natural. And so only a few months after the Goldwater defeat in 1965, the YAFers were already promoting the possibility of a Ronald Reagan candidacy for governor of California. The February 1966 cover article in the organization's national magazine, The New Guard, was titled, "The Republican More Like JFK Than Any Other," a characterization that would be viewed as prescient several years later when Reagan entered the White House. Even before he had been elected governor, a number of YAF activists were focusing on Reagan as a future presidential candidate. In a poll of 175 YAF members at their summer 1966 leadership conference, the preference for 1968, thinking 2 years ahead, was Reagan 53%, Goldwater 30%, Nixon 15%, and Romney 1%. The torch had already been passed from Goldwater to Reagan, even before Reagan had been elected governor. By the end of 1966, YAF had clearly had a new hero who had become the governor of the largest state. As Bill Saraceno, who was very active from the early days of YAF, noted, after he became governor, Reagan was a shorthand way of describing what YAF stood for. And it continued as Reagan took office in Sacramento as governor, and then the next rumors started coming and the next moves to make Ronald Reagan not just governor of California, but a presidential candidate and hopefully eventually president. So YAF was very involved, our individuals in YAF were very involved in 1968 in the effort at Miami Beach, where Reagan was at the last minute became a somewhat candidate for the presidential nomination. Those of you who remember those days and were following politics, that was a very, very close convention that Richard Nixon won the nomination on the first ballot by 25 votes because there was not only Nixon, there was Reagan, there was Rockefeller, and there were a number of what were called favorite son delegations at the time. And so Nixon was able to win by a margin of 25 votes that he over the number that he needed on the first ballot. And many observers of the time and subsequently have said that, you know, if it had gone on to a second or a third ballot, it's very likely that Reagan could have been the nominee in 1968 as more delegations shifted away from the front runner, who was Nixon at the time. But Nixon did win the nomination and went on to win the presidency. And then was reelected, and then we had Watergate. So we're back to 1968 in Miami Beach. And one of the most unforgettable experiences in Miami Beach for many of the YAFers took place when a group of some 30 YAF members welcomed Reagan to his headquarters hotel. And Youth for Reagan leader Mike Thompson recalled, Reagan came in, sat with us in the lobby, talked to us for about 20 minutes and thanked us, quite a guy. And I think that sums up the kind of the personal nature of Ronald Reagan and his relationship with young conservatives. The willingness to give time, the willingness to share with them, the willingness to thank them for their efforts on helping his candidacy at the time. But it gets even better because when Reagan lost the nomination, out of the arena came groups of YAF kids with Reagan signs, disheartened for the loss, but excited nonetheless. up to one group of these young Reagan supporters came a black limousine and stopped. Down came the back window, and there was Governor and Mrs. Reagan. They chatted with these kids and thanked them. The next day, a group of students with Reagan bumper stickers all over their cars was parked at a traffic light, and they hear a car honking next to them. There was Reagan, window down in his limousine, and he thanked the kids. He said, "It was experiences such as these that endeared Ronald Reagan to these YAF members, many of whom would go on to play critical roles in future presidential campaigns, including those of Reagan himself in 76, 1980, and 1984. Again, testimony to the personal nature of Ronald Reagan, his support for young people, and particularly for those in YAF who were supportive of his efforts in his effort in 1968. Well, after two terms as governor of California, Ronald Reagan was no longer in public office and was looking for an avenue to continue to express his political views and his philosophical positions on issues. And so with Reagan out of office, Young America's Foundation initiated the Reagan Radio Project that was directed by Frank Donatelli, YAF's executive director. As author Craig Shirley noted, a long, warm relationship had existed between the old actor and the young YAFers. The foundation raised contributions to sponsor a 5-minute daily broadcast of political commentary by Reagan. And these radio broadcasts helped to gain even greater name recognition and support for the former California governor prior to his announcement of candidacy in November 1975. After the 1976 effort, Reagan resumed his broadcast and they continued until 1979. But so the Reagan Radio Project, which was a project of Young America's Foundation in the period from 1975 on to the 76 campaign began, was an essential element in really getting more national exposure, not only of Ronald Reagan, but of his views on the issues, and really brought him into the consideration nationally as a leader philosophically as well as politically, and helped to boost him into that 1976 campaign. And when the campaign began in 1976, the members of the Reagan campaign team composed a virtual who's who in YAF annals. In fact, of the 40 national staff members of Citizens for Reagan, almost half of the executive staff either were then or were once active YAF members. The Youth for Reagan operation in the various states was headed in most instances by YAF members. And literally thousands of YAF members volunteered for the effort to gain the Republican presidential nomination. And then came the 1976 convention in Kansas City. I was honored and pleased to be a Reagan delegate to that convention and when I was teaching political science in Arkansas and was elected as a Reagan delegate from that state. In the end, a total of 93 YAF members and alumni were represented on the convention floor, with 45 as delegates and 48 as alternate delegates. Reflective of its strength in all areas of the country, these YAF members could be found in 27 different state delegations. So the spreading, these now 16 years after the organization's creation, had produced individuals who had matured and got to the position where they were taking leadership positions within the conservative movement and getting elected as Reagan delegates, again, from 27 different state delegations. But it doesn't end, as we all know. Unfortunately, 1976 was not a successful campaign, but it was really the precursor for what was to happen 4 years later, and that is the 1980 campaign. And by 1980, YAF was once again at the heart of the Reagan movement. The spring 1980 issue of New Guards featured a special section on Ronald Reagan, conservative choice in 1980, Across the country, YAF chapters became an organizing base for student support for Reagan, and as they had in 1976, several YAFers were elected as delegates and alternates to the Republican National Convention in Detroit. It was, again, a movement that involved young people backing Reagan, and at this time they were successful in helping him gain the nomination in Detroit and eventually, a few months later, becoming President of the United States. So then what happens after Reagan becomes president? Well, he's looking for people to serve in his administration on various positions. If you remember, this was also a time when Republicans took control of the Senate. And so there was a lot of shift in Senate staffers because, as probably you know, the committees in the Senate and the House, the staff is 2-1 for whichever party is in the majority. And since the Republicans were coming into the majority, all these key committees were now their staff positions going to shift over. Where there'd been 2 Democrats for every 1 Republican, now there'd be 2 Republicans for every 1 Democrat. So comes the beginning of 1981, and there's a whole slew of positions to be filled in Washington, D.C., in the Senate, in the White House, and in the various positions in the executive branch. The list of YAFers who joined the administration was extensive, as Ken Grasso, who was then a New York YAF state chairman and now is a professor of political science, observed, practically everyone under 40 in the administration is an alumnus of YAF. By the summer of 1981, it was reported that some 50 YAF members or alumni had been appointed to the White House staff, and outside the White House complex itself, YAF members and alumni held other key positions in the administration. Well, this was great for the conservatives. It was not so great for the liberals on the left. And one of the writers who commented at that time was a left-wing writer by the name of Molly Ivins, who is no longer with us, but has written a number of books. Maybe you've heard of her. For Molly Ivins, there was little satisfaction in the fact that many of these conservatives in government were former YAFers. She said, "The government has been taken over by YAFers. All of you one-time college students will remember YAFers, the Young Americans for Freedom," and according to her, "who used to bustle around on campus in those dorky suits like Mormons on speed. Well, now they're in Congress. Some of the new representatives were just young Republicans in college rather than YAFers, which is worse news, because at least YAF had that nice, goofy subset of libertarians who were a lot of fun. Young Republicans were never fun. Anyway, that was the reaction of one liberal writer to the fact that now that some 20 years after its creation, leaders of Young Americans for Freedom were at the stage where they were being elected to Congress and where they were taking positions in White House staff and other roles in the Reagan administration. So during the Reagan presidency, a number of people not only had positions, but the Young Americas Foundation with their summer conferences were invited to the White House each year, and the president hosted a number of events, including a number of his staff people with the students who were attending the Young Americas Foundation conferences. Well, by 1989, Reagan is out of the White House, and the last little anecdote that I have to share with you involves his return to California. One YAF member of the time was honored to drive the Reagan's personal baggage from the airport to their home in Bel Air when the president returned from California on January 20, 1989. It was the experience of a lifetime for John Fleischman, who's now a political commentator in Southern California. And this is what he had to say. "While unloading the luggage, I had a chance to meet the former president in his closet, actually. I told him I was with Young Americans for Freedom and thanked him for everything he had done for our country. He smiled and thanked me for bringing in his luggage. He also expressed his appreciation for everything that YAFers had done to support him throughout his time in public office and during his presidency. It was a very short exchange, but one I will remember forever. And of course, Reagan's ongoing commitment to YAF was reinforced a few years later for Fleischman, who had been California YAF state chairman. And he sent out a fundraising letter to send YAFers to the Conservative Political Action Conference in Washington, which is coming up again, I think, the end of February, and is a major event where a number of young conservatives show up, and a whole slew of conservative speakers are there, and they have an opportunity to hear from them and meet them. And this is, again, back in 1989, so this is some time ago. Well, he sends out this fundraising letter, and back came an envelope from Reagan's office. I opened it to find a $400 check from Reagan, along with a handwritten note to me letting me know that the enclosed check was to help send YAFers to the CPAC conference. And I think that's a commentary not only on Ronald Reagan and the person that he was, but his dedication and devotion to young people and to involving more young people in the conservative movement and building leaders for the future. And of course, that's what Young America's Foundation is all about today. Whether it be through its sponsorship of college and high school chapters or clubs of Young Americans for Freedom, whether it be in this building here and all the activities surrounded around the ranch and sharing the legacy of Ronald Reagan and his dedication to conservative principles. That's what Young America's Foundation is all about. That's what Saving the Ranch was all about. That's what having this wonderful facility here on State Street is all about. And that's what sponsoring so many college and high school conferences is all about, preparing conservative leaders for the 21st century. And I think Young Americans for Freedom as an organization has played an important, helpful role in that whole overall objective. Thank you all very much. If anyone has any questions, I think I got a couple minutes for answering a few questions. Anyone? Yes.
Not that I'm too far from you, but when Reagan was in the White House, I know that the YAF Summer Conference, NCSE, was often held in the White House along with him. Were you ever able to either go or meet anyone who did go to that event?
Yes, I did. And normally what it would be is one of the events would be held at the old executive office building, and key staff people, many of whom were YAF alumni, would come and address the group, and then they would have a tour of the White House grounds. Reagan also addressed a couple of the conferences, either in person, as he did at the Conservative Political Action Conference, or on a couple occasions where he couldn't be there in person, he made in those days, probably a DVD videotape, which we don't really use much anymore. But anyway, that was the means of communicating his message to the group. Gentleman back there, too.
First of all, thank you for your very informative talk on the history of the Young Americans for Freedom and Young Americans Foundation. Very interesting. How many current office holders in the federal government, United States government, are there who have been former YAFers?
Ooh, that's a very good question. I guess my best answer would be a slew, which is sort of like when my wife tells me we just use a dollop of sugar in there. You know, it's an unmeasurable measure. But one was Jeff Sessions, who was a YAF member when he was in college in Alabama. Peter King, who's a state congressman from New York. Jim Sensenbrenner from Wisconsin. And these are guys who go way back into the 1960s and are still in Congress. Younger ones would be Alex Mooney from West Virginia, who also was the director of the National Journalism Center for a while and is in his first term. Yes, first term as a congressman from West Virginia. The I'm escaping the woman's name from Washington State, who's a congresswoman. Pardon? Jamie Herrera Butler would be another one. And there are others that I can't think of right now. There's been a number who have retired or moved on to other things since then. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm just not really familiar with Young Americans for Freedom or the foundation. It's the first I've heard of it. But what kind of things does this group do to try to get the conservative message out there? Are there activist-type events that they hold?
Yes.
Or different types of things that they
yes.
do?
Yes. Okay. One of the major things that the foundation does is sponsoring college speakers on campus. And that has become a really important aspect of the overall program, and one that's meeting with more and more resistance, as unfortunately the left has tried to shut down free speech and has tried to block speakers from campuses and create all kinds of disruptive activities. So one is sponsoring speakers. There's a number of action projects around 9/11, Never Forget is one, where campuses are encouraged to put up flags in remembrance of the 3,000 plus that died in that terrorist activity. Another is the No Che Day, to try to really get across the message of who Che Guevara was, who suddenly has become this hero to so many people who know nothing about who he was and how he was a murderer and the vicious terrorist activities that he engaged in. What's another project?
Let's see.
Put you on the spot.
Well,
here.
There's the GPA redistribution project.
Okay. Anyway, there's...
They do things like the Raisins for Planned Parenthood or anything.
Do they do what now?
Do they do anything for life?
It's some chapters do. I think that has been an activity that some have been involved in. Yes. Yeah. Okay, another question over here.
Could you share a personal story or your relationship and how it really impacted you?
In the organization or in?
With President Reagan.
With President Reagan, okay. Well, I think, first of all, being active in YAF, I knew of Reagan and how he was a principled conservative and how he was going to be someone whose future leadership would be important for the movement. And so after I received my PhD in political science in 1974, in 1975 I got a job teaching at Arkansas State University. And it was an interesting department because, unlike so many departments, we had five who were basically conservative and five who were Democrats and liberals, and there were 10 of us in the department. So it was a very, very great place to work. But I got involved right away in the Reagan campaign, and the establishment of the Republican Party in Arkansas was all for Gerald Ford. And so it was an effort to try to get the nomination for Reagan. And I got elected as a delegate, and I served on the Rules Committee. But at that point, I'd never met Reagan. And it was only after the campaign, before the election in November, but after the summer campaign, that Reagan came to Little Rock, and he met with all the people who had been, there were 16 of us, I think, who had been Reagan delegates. And that was the first time I really met him and saw, you know, the humanity of Ronald Reagan and his outgoing nature and his personality. And so that was the first time that I ever met him. Subsequently, through my activity in the party and then my appointment to the Department of Education, I got to meet him. But, you know, only from a distance. I can't say that I ever worked with him closely like some of the people in the organization did.
Did you have a question? Oh, no, you're good. Okay. Any other questions?
Thank you all very much. I think they're going to have some books for signing and giving you a copy of the book. Is that right? And again, if you want the long history, it's in this book, which is available downstairs.
Yes.
Mr. Thorburn has graciously volunteered to stay and sign some books. The books are complimentary if you would like to have one. So he'll be over here. We'll get the books set up. Thank you all for being here. If you guys have any questions, Mr. Thorburn did a wonderful job describing what we do. But if you have any additional questions, let a staff member know. We have some great YAF students here who I'm sure have some great stories. But we will be here. So let us know if you have any more questions.